So this is a very different process, very different experience, I think, that you all are going to have today than anything that we've done in the past, other than the previous community stories that we've had. It's real. I know it says real stories, but these are people's real stories. This isn't made for TV, edited. This is what those of us whose stories have been represented, this is what we all lived and have experienced. And to me, there's nothing more powerful, and I'm sure my incredibly talented deputy mayor feels the same way, as we were the, I don't want to say guinea pigs at the first one, but our stories were told at the first one, and sitting in the audience and hearing your story told is a very strange feeling. But, you know, if it has an impact, if our story can have an impact and change lives, then that's what it's really all about. We talk a lot in St. Petersburg about our vision of being a city of opportunity where the sun shines on all who live, work, and play. And I always like to focus on that one part about it being a city of opportunity where the sun shines on all. And that's really what this is about, too. This is about changing the culture of the city so that we truly are a community where the sun has an opportunity to shine on everyone. And when you hear people's stories and you hear what they've gone through and their life experiences and what they've been like, it's powerful. And that impact can change lives. And that certainly is what we're hoping this does, that we hope that this changes the way you think about things, the way you feel about things, the way you interact with other people. So that we really do create a community where we are tolerant of everyone, where diversity and different opinions matter, and where we care about everyone, because that's what a community is. It's a place where everyone cares about each other. And so I'm thankful to all of you for coming out tonight. This is an incredible turnout, and it makes me feel really good to see this many people here, because that means that all of you care about this community and you love your city. Otherwise, you wouldn't take your time to be here tonight. So thank you for being here. Thank you for being a part of this great city, and I hope you find your time tonight meaningful and impactful. Thank you all.
I just want to thank not only the mayor and the deputy mayor for being courageous enough to share their stories with us that first time, but I also want to thank the city for being courageous enough to take on an innovative new approach to community conversation. So thank you. Thank you for trusting us to do it. We are your real stories. Want to introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Dr. Lillian Dunlap, and I'm co-artistic director and co-founder of Your Real Stories. And this is Jaye Sheldon, and she's also co-artistic director and founder of Your Real Stories. And Your Real Stories is a storytelling company. That's what we do. We gather the stories of people. And we don't just gather them so that we can look at them and say, oh, what a nice story. We gather them so that we can use them to bring people like you together to talk across differences. That's our challenge, and that's the challenge that we give to you, to keep reaching out and listen to people's stories and share your story and see what the magic is.
So we're not going to talk much longer because we have a really wonderful show planned for you tonight. So I just want to draw your attention to your programs. They're folded in half, and that will tell you what you're about to see, whose stories and which actors are here tonight portraying these wonderful stories for you. Just so that you know what you're about to see, Dr. Dunlap and I sat in these people's homes for 2, 3, 4 hours, and out of that have created 8-minute scripts for you, approximately. So that's what you're about to see, portrayed by professional actors. So I think that's it. So please pay attention to your programs and
get ready for This Is My City, St. Pete's Stories.
Well, my name is Catherine Weaver. I grew up right here in Jordan Park on 24th Street across from Jordan Elementary. I am an artist. I've been with my husband for 23 years, but before I met him, I was a domestic violence survivor. I've been homeless 5 times. I went to Jordan Elementary School through the 4th grade. It was right across the street, so I was never late. It was a fun time. In 5th grade, because of desegregation, they bussed us out of the neighborhood and I went to Tyrone Elementary. After that, I went to Azalea Middle. I fought a lot at Azalea. That's when Roots was out. I was very prejudiced. They had, for them to integrate and desegregate us, that wasn't working. I didn't understand. They wasn't teaching Black history. So you go watch Roots and all you gonna do is get mad. They wasn't explaining it. So you see it, you take it, and you run with it. So I took it out on everybody. I fought Black kids in my neighborhood, boys and girls. But in school, the white kids were my target. I also got in trouble for stealing. I don't even know why I did it. I guess I just wanted to see if I could get away with it. At 14, I was considered a juvenile delinquent because I skipped school all the time. And when I was in school, I was fighting and got suspended all the time. Like, I don't even know how I graduated. I hated school, but I liked art. And in high school at Dixie Hollins, art class was the only time I got A's on my report card. Art came so naturally. It helped me express myself. When I was angry, I wrote poetry. To relax, I drew. So I started putting together the poetry and the drawings. And when something was going on with me, when I felt the world was unfair, and when it was prejudice, I would write about how I felt. Through it all, I matured and I had mentors. See, that was the best thing the judge could have ever did, was court order me to that program at age 14. It did save my life. The mentors from JSP, the Juvenile Service Program, sent me to this youth program to teach you how to do interviews. Now, I was a good kid. I could communicate very well. So I would talk to the adults, and the 2 adults who were there were the youth counselors. They befriended me. One was white and the other was Black, and both of them I was friends with for years. So they constantly helped me along the way, and my attitude started getting better because of them. Now, I do have 3 kids by 3 different people. I mean, that's just what it was. That's just what I was going through, you know? You know what they say about looking for love in all the wrong places. Well, I had my first son, broke up with his father, had a relationship and had my second son, then got married, and in the midst of being married to my first husband, that's when I had my 3rd son. Now, after I found out my first husband had been cheating on me for years, I left him. I was trying to get back at him by going out to clubs and meeting lots of guys. You know, that was young thinking. And during that time, I met a man who was a really good dancer. And the first time we were intimate, he said, "You're mine now." Now, at the time, I thought it was a compliment. It wasn't. For 3 months after that, he threatened me in front of my children, hit me, cursed at me, and eventually became addicted to crack. And one Christmas Eve, he gave me $100 to hold for him and kept coming back for $20 every hour. And when it was down to the last $20, I knew that he would take my children's Christmas presents after he had run out of money. So I called CASA, and they helped me and eventually relocated me. See, that's the thing about domestic violence. If I wouldn't have experienced a bad relationship, I wouldn't appreciate a good one. My husband now of 23 years, we have never fought, not once. Now, we disagree. but we have never physically fought. He's never disrespected me in any form or fashion. Now look, I met this man at the laundromat. I was washing my clothes and he passed by in a car and he saw me. Ooh, honey, I was a cute little thing back then. And he came by and he said, you got a boyfriend. And at that time I was promiscuous, so I had friends. I had like five of them at a time, you know, one to pay rent, one to do this, one to do that. So I said, I have friends. And he said, well, I'd like to be your friend. And I said, well, I guess I got room for one more. Much how the conversation went, and we started talking constantly every day. And he was not like the other guys. I mean, this man talked to me for 3 months straight before he touched me, and I was like, what is your problem? Now, that was something different for me. He just wanted to get to know me. Every place I've ever lived, I've always had an art room. But at that time, I was frustrated because I felt like I wasn't being respected as an artist. So I hadn't used the room in almost a year. And during that 3 months when we were talking, he said, well, what do you do? And I said, I'm an artist. Well, he had never met an artist. So he was like, really? Draw something. So I drew him a picture, and he was so impressed. He was like, so why you not doing it? And he went into my art room, and he totally cleaned it up. All new materials, whatever I needed. And he said, do your art. And from that point on, that man has been my number one supporter. Now, people don't pay any attention to it. But what you do as a child is what is who you are. If you got a child that talk a lot, well, they gonna be doing something with their talking. So when I was like 5 years old, I drew on the bedroom wall. I drew all over the house. Remember a long time ago, that pamper box with a picture of the baby with the blanket over his head? It was so cute. Oh, I drew that picture, but I made it a black baby. I was 10 years old then. I drew it in charcoal, and it was this big. And I put it on the back of the couch because they wouldn't hardly let me hang nothing up or put on the wall. So I just set it on the back of the couch. And my sister-in-law, my brother's wife, she just come walking in one day and was like, who drew that picture? And they all like, it's Catherine. And they didn't even see me. You know how like Michael Jackson and them didn't pay no attention to Janet? And she was like dancing and getting it, and they were all into something else. They weren't paying me no attention. I'm all drawn all over the walls, and I done drew that picture and set it on the couch so it was on display, and it was my art gallery, and they didn't pay no attention. But my sister-in-law, she passed by it like, y'all don't see this baby? This baby is an artist. She said, y'all don't see this child? She's an artist. And I swear, from that moment, she always followed me. And when I graduated, she is the one that talked me into commercial art school. Don't y'all see that baby drawn all over the place? And that's how people are. You know, you singing and cooking and doing hair and whatever, and they don't even pay any attention to it. That's your natural God gift. You can go and critique it, but it's already there. That is the passion and the drive. That's what people need, and that's what makes you happy. That's your future. So this past summer, I worked on an art project in Williams Park, trying to teach homeless people to tell their story through poetry and art to express themselves. People go through a lot of things and they hold on to it. People got secrets. That's why they go to therapy, because they gotta talk to somebody. Or they fall into a state of depression or get involved in drugs, because all people wanna be heard. Mm-hmm. Now, when they first opened the Carter G. Woodson Museum, they originally said that they wanted to tell the story of all the people who had been there here forever. And it was featured in a paper, but it didn't go any further. And a lot of people were very offended by that, because it's like, you know, it's just like with the Manhattan. B.B. King and all these stars used to come in. And it's like, how you gonna redo it? All the older people in the 80s and 90s couldn't wait. They were like, whoa, we gonna get a chance for somebody to say what we went through? Ooh. And a lot of them died off, and it never happened. Not on the level that it should have happened, you know? And they were very disappointed. You erase their history. See, their history is their life. So you put these buildings there, and you say that they're historical, but they are not looking like they used to look. You change everything. You've lost the memory. You gotta go deep. And personally, I don't go to the Martin Luther King Jr. parade. It doesn't have no substance. It doesn't have the substance of what that man stood for, what he died for. Don't play with people's lives. You gotta be real. You gotta go there, because they live. They got a story. That's their legacy. That's why they're here, you know? That's the purpose of their life. And if somebody don't tell it and have to keep it going, it dies with them. And it goes into the grave, and the next generation never heard it. And they need it, especially now. They have a major identity crisis that they don't know who they are. They don't know where they come from. Thank you.
I'm Willie Rogers. On my next birthday, I will be 101 years old. I am a Tuskegee Airman. We had to fight for it. We had to fight for it. I wasn't no fly. I was mostly a jack of all trades, and mostly my work was in the administrative department. During World War II, I was classified S1 and S2. That's why I have to be careful about how I talk about it. I was a master sergeant with the 100th Air Force Squadron, but I was a warrant officer when I was transferred to Tuskegee, the 99th. They had all black bombardier squad, the 477, but President Roosevelt wouldn't let them fly. He canceled it. Five of us approached Roosevelt to complain about the treatment that we got in the service. You know, Horn's husband was in that group with us. We got hold of Edward Brooke, who wasn't a senator yet, but he worked with A. Philip Randolph. They got us an appointment to speak with President Roosevelt. Yes, I was a fighter back then. It was 70 years before the 99th we got any recognition. You know why? In 1974, they claimed that all the records got burned up. It was 70 years before I got full recognition. Not only for me, but for all of them. Chappie James, Henry Stewart, Midnight, and all them boys. It was 70 years. We had to fight for it. I was involved in the movie Red Tails. Some of it was true, and some was not. They didn't never mention all the good things the 99th and the 100 did. All the medals, most of that, they didn't tell it. You'd be surprised the way they talked about the war in the newspapers in those days. Two-thirds of it was all fibs. I can't even talk about it. I never did too much talking anyway. Never did. I have been coming in and out of St. Petersburg since I was 4 years old. But I was born in Apalachicola, 81 miles northwest of Tallahassee. My uncle lived in Bradenton and my mother lived in Palmetto, where my sister was born. We had to come by ferry. There was no bridge then. I remember when this place didn't have but about 500 people. The paper wasn't but 5 cents. My auntie founded the Seventh-day Adventist Church here in this city. So I've been coming in and out of here ever since I was 4 years old. I went to elementary school in Apalachicola and Point St. Joe. My granddaddy raised me. When I finished the eighth grade, they didn't have a high school. So when I was 17 years old, my uncle told me to choose. There was only 3 accredited high schools for blacks in Florida then. One was Lincoln High in Tallahassee, one in Jacksonville, and Booker T. Washington in Pensacola. So I went to Lincoln High in Tallahassee. I graduated in 1936. So my uncle say, "Now, where do you want to go to college?" He said, "You can go to Tuskegee, you can go to Hampton Institute, or you can go to Coughlin. I went to Coughlin College. So that's where I was until I went into the service. When I came out of the service, I was eligible for 4 years of college on the GI Bill. Went back to Coughlin and graduated. Then, taking up 2 more years in business administration at UCLA. Then I taken up electronics. I was out there when they claimed Sirhan killed Robert Kennedy. I was in the electronic business for 36 years here. Rogers, radio, TV, and sales service. First, I had a little hole in the wall on 12th Street, then I moved to 7th Avenue, then moved to 1819 5th Avenue South in front of the trailer park. I was doing my own financing, but I wouldn't tell people that. Instead, I would say, if y'all don't pay me, the Goodyear finance people will come and take your furniture. It won't be me, it'll be them. You see, I've seen a lot of changes in St. Petersburg over the years. To me, there was a white fellow who did more for integration than anybody else. In 1952 or 53, somewhere along there, they had some green benches downtown. Black people couldn't sit on the green benches. This white fellow was out there. He saw black people standing outside the store. He asked them why they didn't sit down. They said they couldn't. But he said, "Go on, sit down." When the police came, they said, "Didn't you see the sign?" And the white fella said, "I took that sign down and I told them to sit there. So you should arrest me. And if you do, I'll sue the city, I'll sue the county, then I'll sue the state." The police just walked on by. The next two people I give more credit is a fella named Waller and another fella. I can't think of his. I got Waller. I can't think of the other fella's name right now. So it's Waller and Waller? Okay. Waller and another fella named Waller. They did something I wanted to do. They used to have a Merle downtown in City Hall. Mm-hmm. I was in the Voters League and the IBPOEW, the Independent Benevolent and Protective Order of Elks. So we called a special meeting to discuss that mural that showed black minstrels entertaining some white people. And then these two fellas, Waller, walked right there in City Hall and pulled that mural off the wall. I wanted to do it. I'll tell you, that's the truth. I'll be honest about it. I wanted to do it, but I just didn't have the nerve. Well, I taught for a while here at the 16th Street School, John Hopkins. John was the principal there. I have to smile every time I talk about it. I remember that I had a stencil that needed to be run off, and John had told me to ask someone in the office to run it off. I called him John because he was my cousin. I went into the secretary and said, John said, have someone run these stencils off. He said, can't you say Principal John? So I had to ask John to talk to the secretary. So John said to the secretary, you call me John unless I am around some of my distinguished guests. I've been in the AME Church 91 years. Mm-hmm. I've been a member of Bethel AME Church for 76 years. Mm. I am the oldest thing in the church. Lord have mercy. I'm like their pet. I'm very quiet. They give me the Unsung Heroes Award. They give me the highest award in the AME Church, the Torch Award. The bishop had to approve it. Mm-hmm. He finally approved it. Our representative, Daryl Rousson, and Commissioner Wells sent a representative to give me an award. We had two celebrations. The mayor awarded me the key to the city. But that don't mean I'm better than anybody else. I ain't no better than that man who drink his wine and don't know where his next one's coming from. It was for distinguished service and my age. Well, I think my age more than anything else. Thank you.
My name is Myrtle Williams. I was born and raised in Lakeland, Florida. We were poor, but we didn't know it. Nobody told us, and everybody around us was poor. We had a mom who was a really hard worker. When she was in her 40s, she took correspondent nurses courses, went to the state of Florida, and made the second highest score. My daddy was the first black deputy sheriff of Polk County. He was a big NAACP man, big in his church, that sort of thing. My dad was very unusual. He actually integrated a white hospital. No doctor had admitted him, but he was sick. So he went to the white hospital and said he wanted to be admitted. And eventually, they did admit him. That was during the time when race was really starting to boil over. When I went to college, we still had white restrooms and black restrooms and separate water fountains. My parents believed in education. I was always in the Honor Society. I got a scholarship to Talladega College in Alabama, and I really enjoyed it. But, you know, I couldn't have gone to college in Lakeland, Florida, even if I wanted to, because it was segregated. I graduated college in 1966, married a man from St. Petersburg, and moved to Kansas City. I started teaching mathematics in an all-African-American inner-city school in Kansas City. It was somewhat intimidating the first year of teaching. I had some students who had two or three kids, and some of the girls, where their pimps were dropping them off to school in the morning time and picking them up after school. Some of them would come to see me after school. They all just wanted someone that they could talk to. I became involved in some of the club activities so that I could get to know them outside of class. We could discuss different kinds of things, like self-esteem and developing themselves as a whole, rather than always being dependent on a man. I taught there for 6 years and had started my master's degree at the University of Missouri at Kansas City. When I left, I was 26 years old and head of the math department. So I left an all-black environment to come to St. Pete in 1973. I started working at St. Petersburg High School that same year. That was the first year Mr. Verl Davis, an African-American, had been selected to be principal there. And he was given charge to develop his own team. That was my first integrated experience of teaching white children. Here I was in the richest white neighborhood and never taught those kids before. So again, it was a little intimidating. Mr. Davis appointed me to the 9th grade cheerleader advisor. When we had the cheerleader tryouts, this was a really big thing because blacks weren't on the cheerleading squad before. I picked 2 black girls. And it was really good for them to see that they could integrate into the biggest St. Pete High system. I went from 9th grade cheerleader advisor to the sophomore advisor, and eventually I was senior varsity cheerleader advisor. My daughter was the cheerleading mascot. I consider that a blessing because I was able to keep her involved and spend time with her. And I know I would not have been able to do this if probably she had been a boy. Now, one time, I brought all the varsity cheerleaders to my house, and they were so anxious to see what my house looked like. It was the late 70s, and at that time, we were wearing afros and afro wigs, and they got all up in my closet and tried on wigs. You should have saw them. They found out I was human just like they were. And we could just laugh and talk. And so those girls, we developed such a relationship. And with their parents, too. I got invited to Snail Island. Never been out there before. With all of the girls, we just really hit it off. I was at St. Pete High for 5 years. Then I was assistant principal at Meadow Lawn for 3 years. In 1980, I got a call from the president of St. Petersburg College. He was looking for some new talent. And would I be interested in that? And I said, sure. Anytime I had an opportunity to grow, I was interested in it. Over the years, I was financial aid director, then interim director of Dean of Students at SPC Gibbs campus, assistant provost, and eventually, I became the first associate provost on the Gibbs campus. I was there from 1984 until I retired in 2008 to take care of my mother. I believe in the whole student. I believe in the integration of academia with students' personal life, their social life, and financial life. Because if any of those parts don't work right, the student can't be successful. I had married my husband right after I graduated from college, but we eventually divorced. He was a police officer in Kansas City, Missouri, and he got moved up and worked up to detective, and he was doing a lot of undercover stuff, and that's a different life. His interest in his work and this street, he got too involved in it, and we didn't have any more family time. He had had to kill a man in the line of duty. He defended himself, and he was fine. But mentally, that just didn't go well for him. He took some time off, and that's when he decided he wanted to come home to St. Pete. I didn't didn't know a lot of this until later on, but I do think that anytime men go through those things, they need a lot of counseling, a lot of help. And men go through these things, and families do too, because you don't really understand the radical change. It didn't work out for us, but he's deceased now. Yes, that is part of life. My daughter was his only child. She had mom and dad. I tried to make that possible. I knew some things weren't quite right, but I knew that that was important. Every girl needs to be loved by their father and have a mother that's going to stand by them. So I did the best I could, and I think my daughter would agree. This is kind of personal, but men, because of the positions I've always been in, one of authority, you know, sometimes you walk the walk and you talk the talk, thought I was more of one of these little snotty, you know. So it really did affect some of my social life. You would think two educated people could do so much together, but that wasn't the way it was perceived. They would rather have somebody a little less, should I say, I'm aggressive but assertive. I think that affects a lot of black women, because with your education, you don't want to appear to be better than anyone else, but then you carry yourself a certain way. I have no regrets about that. So if I lost somebody because of that, then it was meant to be. I can say that now. But I didn't like it back then. But then men will say, you're not anything like I thought you were. What does that mean? I guess they mean bossy, controlling, or nitpicky. But I just try to be human. When I was younger, I used to be bothered me more than, you know, the older you get, it's not as important as it used to be. I mean, I have a lot of good friends and things like that. Last year, I was diagnosed with cancer. So I don't even say I'm a cancer survivor now, because I'm still taking chemo. And I can tell you that my whole family has just supported me. When I was in the hospital and I couldn't do anything for myself, I had round-the-clock care from nurses and doctors and stuff. And I never spent one day in the hospital by myself, at night either. And when I came home, my family was here just doing shifts and everything. So God is good. He has blessed me. And I just thank him for every day that he's given me. So I just feel there are women who don't have that type of support and they need it. There's a lot of work that we need to do. So if we can do anything to help women in this situation, telling their story, how you get through it, how you talk through it, what you eat, what you do, what we need to do, because so many people are just so alone, and that's bad. I'm happy to say I'm progressing well, and I did the first treatment real well, but my body needs some rest. I'm just thinking positively. I think I have a lot more work to do, and I have a lot to give. God is good. Shout it, oh Lordy. I just thank him every day. And you know what? You just never know. I thought I was taking care of myself. I thought I was eating well, and I had gone to get my colonoscopy, and it had been about 5 years since my last one. And they didn't see anything the last time. But when I went back, the tumor was pretty large. So you never know. All of us have our own cross to bear. And it's not the same, but it's ours. And how we deal with it, and how we deal with what God has given us, is really going to be the way you lift yourself up out of it. is so good. And I am so blessed. Thank you.
My name is Marika Robinson. I was born in Czechoslovakia. I was not born deaf. When I was about a year and a half old, something happened. My uncle loved bicycles, and he would set me up on the bicycle handlebars in front of him so I could feel the wind on my face, and I loved that feeling. It felt like I was flying. So whenever my uncle came over, I would ask to ride on the bicycle. But he would make me wait until he asked my mom. Well, one time while he was talking to my mom, I pulled the bicycle down on top of me. There was blood everywhere. I screamed, and they rushed me to the hospital. I was actually in a coma and had to have surgery. Afterwards, the doctor announced that he had good news and bad news. I had woken up from the coma, which was the good news, but the bad news is that I was deaf. And my mother asked him, what does deaf mean? And the doctor said, deaf means that when she grows up, she will never be successful. In Czechoslovakia, if you had anything less than a 60% hearing, you had to go to the deaf school. If you had 60 to 100% hearing and could speak, you could go to the regular school. Well, I went to the deaf school. And I loved my teachers, but I was one of the only students whose only disability was being deaf. Most of the others had other disabilities too. So I became an advocate for them. I was very smart. There was a door in the school that was always locked. And one day, the principal unlocked the door just for me. And I felt so special to be let into this secret room. And there were tons of books piled all over the room. Several piles that had been pulled down off of shelves, some partially destroyed. And the principal explained, you see, this is what happens. It's communism. When the government is fixed, we can't do this anymore. You might want to read a book, but if somebody doesn't agree that book is good, they might damage it, so you can't read it. So from then on, I got to go into that room whenever I wanted. That's when I fell in love with books. Faulkner, Jack London, many American writers, such as Lewis Sinclair. Oh, his books were so tragic. And I was inspired by all of the different experiences that I read about. All of my family is very intelligent. They were journalists, judges, lawyers, and professors. But I wasn't able to go to college, even though I was smart. Since I was deaf, by law, I would never be able to go. I cried. When I was little, about 6 or 7, I had seen my father go through a serious depression. My dad told me that he had been in prison. Now, my father had never joined with the Communist Party. He hated it. He had tried to run away to America with his friends, but they were caught crossing the border and were imprisoned. In prison, they made radium, and some of his friends died from radium poisoning. He told me about America, and when I said, I want to be an American, he said, you can't say that. When I was 28 years old, the authorities took my passport for 3 or 4 years because somebody had told them that I was going to leave the country. So it was a long struggle to get here. When I arrived in America, I was 37 years old. I didn't know any English whatsoever, and on top of that, I'm deaf. So communicating with people was not easy, and writing in English was difficult. I screwed up quite often and took some lumps along the way. but I met a lot of deaf people here in America, and they said I was smart and should go to college. I told them in Europe you could only go to school up to the age of 24, and if you didn't finish by the time you were 24, you had to stop. So I was surprised to find out that here in America there were no age restrictions. And I thought, but I'm so old. Well, when I went on campus for the first time, I saw an old woman carrying a book with her glasses around her neck by a chain, and I thought, oh my gosh, this is college here in America. I went to my first lecture. I was so excited. I had much self-esteem at the age of 37, finally. I would look at the other classmates sitting around and doing nothing. And I would say, hey, you should study. And they'd say, yeah, leave me alone. I've got other things to do. And I thought, don't you cherish your education? I sent letters home to my family telling them I was in college. And they didn't believe me. When I told them it didn't matter what your age or disability is, that you could get interpreters in college, it blew their minds. So when I got my diploma, I would tell people, hey, I'm deaf and I have a degree. Well, it might have been a little bit of bragging. I loved everything that I learned. I don't make a lot of money now, but I feel good about myself. I can do something that helps the deaf community. I teach interpreters to go and affect the world across the country. And I see many of them graduating and going to other places. Now understand, when I sign, I have an accent. So when the students graduate and they see someone with an accent, if they're going to another place, they're already used to interpreting for an accent. I've been here in America 19 years, and I am an American citizen. When I left that courthouse, I was so proud to be an American. I was driving home that night, and I thought, being in America is a gift from God. Sometimes I cry thinking back on that night because I was so overwhelmed with emotion. So many people want to move to America, and the process to get a visa is so difficult. I waited for more than 2 years to even be able to touch foot on American soil. So now when I visit Czechoslovakia and I tell them it's time for me to go home, my family says, no, your home is here. And I say, no, my home is in America. I remember growing up wanting to be an American, and now I've had my dream fulfilled. Wow.
My name is Katee Tully. When my life partner Helen and I lived in New York, we went to an event where all the different editors of the New Yorker magazine spoke. And the guy who oversees the cartoon section said in his talk that people have public, private, and secret humor. Mm-hmm. And that people generally participate in public humor and some private. But the secret humor, that just doesn't get out there. These are things you could never explain to somebody who wouldn't find them offensive or sick or something. We all have those public, private, and secret selves across a lot of different circumstances. So that started a conversation with us many years ago. And Helen and I often revisited that. She'll say, nobody would ever picture you doing this. That would not be anywhere in their imagination. Helen and my family are probably the few people who have seen that part of me on a regular accepted basis, slipping into disguise and becoming someone else while I'm with them or riding in an elevator with people who don't know me. I find it fascinating what you can get people to do. One of my favorite possessions is a typewriter with a little silver Christmas tree coming out of it. Helen and I were at Pointer for a lecture, and when it was over, they announced there were prizes. They must have gone through everyone's office and desk drawers and come up with the prizes for the night. You know, things like 8-tracks and stuff. So I told Helen, I need to win that little typewriter with a silver tree growing out of it. So apparently it was the grand prize. And in order to win it, you had to get up and dance as a couple. I knew Helen wouldn't do this. That would be like, pick some absolute worst, most public thing that you could make Helen do and with her peers. And I said, Helen, honey, I really want that. And if you just stand up, I'll do all the work. So she agreed to stand up, the music started, and I danced my heart out. And she just stood there like a totem pole. And we won. For months afterwards, I took that little typewriter tree everywhere. We took it out to dinner. We took it up to Tallahassee. We took it over to our friends' houses. I would carry it in, and I'd put it down. And eventually, someone would ask, and I would get to announce, Helen and I won a dance contest. And then every eye would immediately go to Helen, like, how could that be possible? I guess it started when I was a kid. Whether it was a backyard circus when I was little, or productions we put together when we were older, or international themed dinners and costumes with our neighbors. My experience has always been that people are willing to be led into a little mischief. I actually think people get a little starred for things that are unconventional, a little risque, a little provocative. I think about all the times that I get to come home with some fun story or do something that gives someone else an amazing story to come home with. When Helen and I got married in D.C., everything started out bad about that trip because two very educated women didn't read the pamphlet. We had printed out the announcements. We had done everything. We understood the 5-day waiting period. So we had planned out this incredible trip to pass those 5 days in D.C. And when we got to the courthouse, the woman asked, do you have an officiant? And we hadn't realized that we needed one. So she said, there's a list of about 60 people, and there was only about one or two of them that would marry same-sex couples. So we said, would you mind circling those two names so that we wouldn't have to go through the other 58? And she did. So now we're in this problem-solving mode, and you couldn't have a better problem solver than Helen. So we go down the hallway, and we're standing outside the women's bathroom. We were about the only people there who started out the day happy to be in a courthouse. So it seems like everyone was working out their issues in the women's bathroom. And Helen just started looking through synagogues in D.C. on her phone. She called the very first one. She asked for the rabbi. He was there. And so she explained what was our dilemma was, and why we needed him to come through for us. In the meantime, in the background, all these people are screaming at one another. And he said, are you drunk? Are you at a bar? Are you in jail? And she said, no, it's really real. And he said, well, I have these friends who like to play practical jokes on me, so if you're playing with me. And she said, no. So he agreed to meet us 5 days later. Okay, so fast forward. We showed up. Turns out he's like the rock star rabbi of D.C. He gave us a wedding ceremony that will last us a whole lifetime. And of course, in the Jewish faith, there's something called a ketubah. And you usually spend months having this done in calligraphy. But he went to the web and he downloaded a generic ketubah. And he has, you know, it has the names and the Jewish year and the dates. But all the ones he printed said draft across them. So he had his secretary, who had this typewriter that typed in Hebrew, and he types out this ketubah for us. And she made it generic, you know, general, and, general. And, but, so she puts Helen's name in there, and, well, that was an easy thing. And Helen, you know, is Helen Dorothy, and her dad is Dave. And then they get to me. A little Irish white girl. And usually you have to put your Jewish given name. My name is Mary Catherine. And my dad is James Calvin. It was like, all right, well, it is what it is. We had a great time. His staff, they got food out of their lunches that they brought with them, and they sang to us, and it was an amazing ceremony. I just think that you have those moments where you're out of sight of the people and the reference points that you're familiar with, and that's where you get to wrap other people in, and I like wrapping other people in. The installation that I have in my studio now is a sail from a boat when we were younger, and so I did this big prose piece that's really about my love for Helen, but publicly expressed on this sail. And right below it is this old army cot that my sister Lynn gave me, and on that I wrote about how we're all just looking for a place to sleep. Once I thought I found a place under the dome of stars. A lot of people come in to the studio and they just, well, they're just too much, or they're not noticing things. And then sometimes you find that person who just plants themselves right in front of your work, and they're just kind of stopped and transported someplace, having this moment. So I like making these unusual things that might get someone to stop and think about a moment in their life. When I lived in New York, I was the only white administrator at Medgar Evers College. And I knew that I could be the administrator at that school for the rest of my life, and I'd never be black. I'd never be on the inside of some of the conversations that were a part of the institution because I never had a black life. So my way of demonstrating who and what I was about was to sign up for an African dance class. And I was bad. Bad, bad, not good, bad. And I knew I needed to join some things and expose myself and not keep some artificial boundary or be something that I could never be. Joining an African dance class wasn't playing to my strengths, but it was playing to my sensibility. I even wrote a rap song and performed it for the rest at the staff retreat. And I was bad. Not good, bad. But I'm willing to have some fun in my own embarrassment, and I've always been pretty willing to do that. But I think if you have some big change or goal, or you're asking people to do extraordinarily hard things or make great sacrifices, I would say that at the beginning of those journeys, I'm probably the most wired down inside myself, because I want people to see me as someone that you can have confidence in. And sometimes the journey has been just so incredibly hard and arduous, and I never got to that fun place. And I've had some chapters where there was never any reveal. And because that playful, whimsical, mischievous place is natural for me, in those moments when the lid gets screwed on tight and I'm not getting enough oxygen, or it's like sucking oxygen through a straw. But the nice thing is having people who know that part of you, so you can just find them in the wilderness and say, I just need to sit down and be with you and be naked. It's my experience that most people can only go so far with you down your story. You actually have an opportunity to take them just a little further if you can get them to step someplace they didn't expect. It is that private humor, and maybe even the dark humor, that lets people go a little further with you. Whether you got breast cancer, or someone dies, or it's 9/11, some unusual things tumble out of people's mouths. So I find those humorous moments creeping into the telling of those parts of my story. You can't tell your story with those other light pieces in it, without those other light pieces in it, because it's too heavy. When it's too heavy, people sometimes stop walking with you. When you're going through really, really hard times, they don't know how to be. And they're just afraid that they're going to be exposed as trite or uncomfortable or whatever. So they don't call or they don't show up. They don't know how to be or what to do or how to respond. And so they can disappear. Or they just can't be with you or see you during a chapter. Or they send messengers. You know, you'll hear from one of your friends, they'll say, oh, so-and-so said that they'd give you this big squeeze. And, you know, so I just think people sort it out and some of them surface later. Or they take a detour or they join you further down the trail. And I know for myself, when people are going through stuff, sometimes the best that I can do is just like a confessional, be up front. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do for you. I have never had to go through those circumstances. So sometimes I just have to admit that. Even if you don't know what to do or what to say or how to be, don't disappear with the people that you love. Epilogue. What is it when a tree withers and the leaves fall, body exposed to the golden wind? Blue Cliff Record. Indeed, I felt exposed in the golden wind when I first learned I had breast cancer. The toughest part wasn't that long fall. Was not the surgery or the chemotherapy or the hair loss or the daily humiliation of a faltering body, but the simple act of opening the front door to kindness, to fall into comfortable arms and to say yes to kindness, overwhelming acts of kindness. Kindness. By Naomi Shihab Nye. Before you know what kindness really is, you must lose things, feel the future dissolve in a moment. Before you can learn the tender gravity of kindness, you must travel. You must see how this could be you. Before you know kindness as the deepest thing inside, you must know sorrow as the other deepest thing. Then it is only kindness that makes sense anymore, only kindness that ties your shoes and sends you out into the day to mail letters and purchase bread, only kindness that rises its head from the crowd of a world to say, it is you I have been looking for, and then goes with you everywhere like a friend. Thank you.